I hit this green button on my laptop, this timer, the red timer, will begin to count down from 15 minutes to zero. Once it reaches zero, or once I arrive at my final slide, over here is my slide deck, this lecture will conclude. If I have not reached the conclusion of my lecture at the end of these 15 minutes, you get to keep the envelope. If I finish my lecture within 15 minutes, I'm going to ask you to return it to me. During this lecture, my computer will randomly generate performative interruptions, which I am calling, for lack of a better word, a knee. Those knees will show up over here on your left. I have prepared all of these knees in advance. They are not improvised. Each knee is a micro-performance piece with a beginning, an end, and a title. Those titles will display over here on your left. These knees might be task-based, like running a lap around this room, or they might be discrete stories that I'm going to tell you, or they might be something entirely different, where I ask you to help me. When a knee is generated, I will drop everything that I'm doing, I will stop my lecture, I will complete the knee, and then return to delivering this lecture. I don't know what order the knees will come in, or when they will occur, or how long it is until the next knee is generated. All of that is randomized. So depending on how feisty my computer is feeling today, this could either be really easy or really hard. I have prepared the text of this lecture to last around 12 minutes. If I don't complete this text and arrive at my final slide, within that 15 minutes, Andrew, you get to keep the envelope. In the envelope is $50. If I lose the $50 lecture machine, I will lose $50. And then I will also have the number 50, which is the amount of money that I have lost in this performance, tattooed on my body. Over here is a station ready for stick and pokes that my wonderful and very willing partner, Ellie Mejia, will provide. This will happen throughout the night, so you'll be able to see the mark of how much money I have lost. And in addition, every time that I perform this piece going forward, I will also update that number. So if I lose another $50 tomorrow, I'll ask Ellie to cross out the 50 and put in 100. But if I successfully complete this lecture, I get the 50 bucks back, and I won't alter my body in any way outside of my other plans to do so. The last thing that I want to do is, before I start, is I just want to make sure, Andrew, you're a super kind individual, and giving money to someone else is often sort of like a really intense sort of like thing. So what I'm going to have you do is swear on this book, which is not the Bible, but is The Queer Art of Failure by Jack Halberstam, which is the best, next best thing that I've got. So if you can put your right hand over this book. How does this work? Left hand over this book?
Right
hand over the book. Other hand up. I've never done this before. Please repeat after me. I will not.
I will not.
Give Corey. $50.
$50.
Should he lose this performance. I will.
Do anything that I would like.
With this $50.
As long as it does not financially benefit.
Corey. Amen. Cool. All right. Ready to rumble? Let's do this thing. Da-da-da-da-da. Does it begin? I'd like to talk today about a building in downtown Chicago. It's right here, the James R. Thompson Center, designed by Helmut Jahn. The Thompson Center is located at 100 West Randolph Street and takes up an entire city block bound by Randolph, Lake, Clark, and LaSalle Streets. The building, when it first opened in May 1985, was called the State of Illinois Center and was later renamed the James R. Thompson Center in 1993 in recognition of James R. Thompson, Jr., the former Republican governor of Illinois. The overall shape of this glittering and gargantuan object is not easy to understand. It is easiest to start with the floor plan, which is best described as a rectangle that has been broken by a long curve, which runs from one corner to the middle of the opposite side. The straight side... straight sides of this polygonal shape rise straight up, whereas the curving side slopes inward as it rises, giving the building its startling rocket ship-like profile from many different angles. Within, there is a circular atrium that slices through the roof and emerges as a sliced-off cylinder that is the building's crown, looking as if it were about to revolve. Okay, cool. So there are two James R. Thompson Jr.'s that have Wikipedia pages. Here they are. This guy here is the former Republican governor of Illinois. He also later served on the 9/11 commission. This James R. Thompson Jr. Was a NASA executive. He was the vice chair of the NASA task force inquiring into the cause of the Space Shuttle Challenger accident. He became the director of the Marshall Space Flight Center, and later was the deputy administrator of NASA in 89. This building is owned by the state of Illinois and indirectly by me, a taxpayer in the state since 2014. I thought it was a hockey arena at first, but I've since learned what the building is for. It houses state government offices. The capital of Illinois is Springfield, as some of you might know, which is 200 miles... which actually means that 10 feet is like right there. Great. Okay. Oh no, it's going up. It moves on to the next thing. So they built a whole building for offices. The governor has a private office on the top floor. Charged with creating an institution. With the caveat that it was to be a well-used and truly public facility, Jan had drawn inspiration from two primary sources. One was the example set by the design of traditional capitals and other government buildings. From these, he took the idea of a spacious domed rotunda, but reinterpreted it in contemporary materials and shapes. The other was the lively activity of many European village squares and America's big city plazas in the summer. That was the kind of use Jan wanted for the State Center. To make it possible year-round, even in Chicago's frigid winters, he put his plaza... PR problems. It was seen as expensive and over budget. Its total cost was $172 million in public funds. This was erroneously compared to a publicized $85 million for the cost of the core and the shell only. The building's odd shape has altered the maze of offices within each ring. Some are square, some rectangular, some combinations of square and curve. Square and curved. Depending on one's sense of direction, the shape can be exhilarating or merely confusing. All such complaints pale in the face of one big gripe. Many offices don't have doors. Even in a state where strong sunshine laws can make shutting one a civic sin, bureaucrats don't like to do without doors. Due to some miscalculations during construction, some cost-saving mechanisms, and some design flaws, the building has become synonymous with the problems that plague it. In 1985, for instance, the year the building opened, the building suffered from a small rat infestation, a sprinkler system malfunction causing a cascade of water from the ceiling of the 14th floor offices of the State Board of Education, a group of mysterious stains appeared on the polished granite flooring in the lobby, and the glass atrium made the whole building into a big greenhouse in the summer. Chicago Tribune, John Campbell, a comptroller office employee, switches on a fan on August 5th. On August 5th, 1986, in the State of Illinois Center, temperatures soared into the 90s in the parts of the building, during last month's heat wave. In warm weather, 8 giant ice cubes, each weighing 100,000 pounds, are frozen at night, when electric charges are about half the daytime rate, then used to cool the building the following day. The 40 by 12 by 14 foot cubes are frozen in huge ice banks in the building's sub-basement, 37 feet below street level. Chicago Tribune, Joseph J. Annuzio, Attorney General of the State Environmental Control Division, and William W. Frykes, Assistant Division Chief, use an umbrella to battle heat and glare from the sun in the State of Illinois Center, July 16, 1986. On an aesthetic level, it's a really bizarre, beautiful postmodern building, sort of overwhelming in its power. The salmon pink and baby blue, the... Can you try this?
Yeah.
Can you try this in another?
Really
tight? Yes, please. Just enough to get the incoming. Thank you so much. Sort of overwhelming in its power. The baby blue and salmon pink, the gigantic atrium, the glass exposing the insides of the building. The blue panels of glass on the facade are surely the most disturbing thing of all. Their turquoise color it calls to mind cheap commercial buildings of the 1950s, bus stations and suburban schools and the like. Is Helmut Jahn, whose sense of trends is as sharp as any fashion designer's, doing this intentionally, gambling that the current vogue for 1950s design will eventually grow to encompass even the dreariest relics of that decade? I doubt it. Of state classical capitol buildings. It inverts the modernist tower and plaza concept, moving public space inside and squashing the tower into a cylindrical form, reminiscent of state capitol buildings. The dream of the 80s is alive here. Techno-capitalism, transparency in government, the sanitized and air-conditioned flair of a shopping mall, a neoliberal blurring of private and public space, the smell of Sbarro in the basement wafts upward so that when you're visiting the offices on the 16th floor, you can smell the pizza being cooked below. Where else can you meet a friend for a cup of coffee, enjoy a light snack or a full dinner, buy a suit? All right, everybody, if you can raise your hand up in the air. All right, now check under your seat, check under your seat, check under your seat, check under your seat. Hey, $1, there we go. Enjoy a light snack or a full dinner, buy a suit, fill a prescription, visit an art gallery and a state agency, renew your driver's license, attend a concert and catch a train home, all without ever going outside. No wonder residents call it Starship Chicago when they're not calling it ruder names. It seems not so much to have risen in the loop as to have landed there. The really good news is it's just a few structural beams and some glass, so it doesn't cost that much to take down. In front of the Thompson Center is a sculpture by Jean Dubuffet called Monument of the Standing Beast. It's a weird piece, but a nice complement to the building itself. The colorful postmodernism of the Thompson Center has a nice balance with the black and white organic forms of Monument with Standing Beast. All right, everybody, if you can pull out your wallet and credit card. We're all going to read the digits of our credit card out loud together. We're all in it together. Is everybody, let's wait for everybody to be ready. Jump in if you're not with us. Ready? 1, 2, 3.
4, 2, 5, 9, 8, 6, 7, 9, 1, 5, 7, 3, 7, 9, 0, 1.
It's a nice shelter in the rain. It's a compounding. impossible to get inside of the building, a kind of black and white fire eternally burning outside. The Department of Motor Vehicles is located in the basement of the building next to that food court. The first time that I went into the building was when I went to switch over my driver's license from a Michigan one to an Illinois one. I wandered in at 11 a.m., which turned out to be a mistake because DMV workers go on break at noon. So I ended up spending almost the whole day in the Thompson Center, killing time at the food court, trying to connect antagonist, 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 trying to connect to the public Wi-Fi. I couldn't make it work, but I did get a mediocre burrito. In 2015, Bruce Rauner, the newly elected governor of Illinois, declared that the state would sell the building, and he voiced support for a buyer who would demolish it. This project has been continued by the... current governor, J.B. Pritzker, who is looking for potential buyers currently. This all raises the question, what is the value of a building like this? The Thompson Center is a very real attempt at a commons, a space for everyone, even if the history falls short of these... Okay, this is from the Walgreens in the Thompson Center. We have $4.99 maximum eye drops, Walgreens brand. $1.79, nice, cold brew coffee black. Subtotal is $6.78. There's 15 cents sales tax, which is a total of $6.93. The fact is, it's one of the few open spaces in the loop, one of the only places in the area to get a cheap bite to eat, a huge transfer station for the CTA. It's worth remembering what the building stands for. Our successes and failures as a state, our collective culture, our body politic. This, too, is not any more than just a game. The atrium is still a spectacular indoor space. The food court is active. Workers and visitors launch the glassy elevators to reach the state offices in the 17-story building. There is sound. There is light. There is sound, there is life. And I might have wanted to change, you know, the color 2 years after it opened, but today I wouldn't change the color. Thank you.
Share some.